Little bit.
Yeah, please.
Yeah. Because last time I think we went up to the particular point. So we will pick it up from there and look at the pre-scene again.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Yeah. So you remember this was a construction company and we were talking about them because it's a company that is in a country and then you are the senior management accountant of this company. And your role is to inform the finance director to provide information and also to enable the company's performance to measure and for, so that is basically the role. So I think we went up to the budget report and we stopped it at the share price. So let's start it from the share price. So you remember there was one competitor for this company. These people are the fourth largest and there is another competitor which is called the Constructmo.
Yeah.
Right. So if you see the share prices, you can see as an index, right? An index, if you look at the share price, is not given per unit, per not given in dollars or whatever. It is given as an index. We can see at the beginning, we can see Constructmo really rising.
Yeah.
Rising, then came down. And then again, it has been rising. Now there's a slight kind of a drop. But our own company, the blue one, the build, we can see we have gone for a big drop in the recent past. And they say last year, despite stiff competition, but the share price, however, is currently at the lowest price in the company's history. The company has struggled to achieve the growth it hoped for. So probably the strategy is not working for them. Something has gone wrong, right? Both the companies started almost at the same level, taking the same index, first March 2012, March 12 index. We can see your competitor has gone up from 100 to about 140, whereas you have come down from 100 to 60. So you seem to be struggling on achievement of the objectives. So, achievement of the objectives, why should you struggle? Maybe your strategies are not working. Maybe you are not getting the right information to get right decisions. Maybe your controls are poor. Maybe your board of directors are not really doing good. There could be some reason for your share price to come down in this manner. So we have to probably keep that in mind. This may be one question that can come up. Why this share price is coming down? What is the reason? So the reasons are probably your strategy is not working. And strategy is not working due to many reasons. So that's all what we need to, what we can find out from that one. Right. So let's go beyond that one. So, market data, the beta. Do you know what it is? What is called a beta?
Beta.
Yeah. Market beta.
I know about the market data.
Market?
Market data. I know about the market data.
Okay.
What is beta?
Yeah. Beta. Right. Okay. I think it's somewhat surprising that because it was not earlier the part of the F2 syllabus. But probably they have put this in the F2 syllabus. So I'm going to discuss a little bit this with you now.
Okay.
So what this data is, I'm going to get the screen a little bit cleaned up so that I can write something. So you as a shareholder or as a company, when you invest your money, there are two kinds of risk that you face in the business world. There are two kinds of risk. One we call the risk that is something what we can manage, what we call unsystematic risk. That is the risk that comes from the environment, right? Unsystematic risk,
okay.
The external risk. So how do you minimize that one as a shareholder? You go and diversify your portfolio. You go and invest in company A. You can invest in company B, you can invest in company C. By doing that way, you can very much minimize that one. But then there's another kind of a risk, what is called the systematic risk. Now that is not a risk which you can manage like that. It is basically it applies to any company for that matter, right? It applies to any company, maybe the weather, maybe the exchange fluctuations, maybe something. It is applying to any company, but that risk also you need to manage. But it all depends. Different companies will manage in different ways. The risk is same for you, risk is same for me. But the way that you manage and the way that I manage may be different. And that is measured by something called beta.
Okay.
Beta. And if the beta is more than one in your company, that means your systematic risk is much more than the market. If beta is equal to one, that means your systematic risk is equal to the market. If beta is less than one, your systematic risk is less than the market. So it all depends on you, how you manage it. So for example, if you look at the British Airways, they had a beta something like 1.753 one time. And the same airline, and in the same trade, the Singapore Airlines had a beta something like 0.854. So it is measured in terms of the fluctuation of the share price, everything. And so you can see Singapore Airlines, the systematic risk is much, much more lesser than British Airways. And that could be accepted because Singapore is a very stable, politically stable country. The policies are stable, whereas UK, the governments may change every 4 years. Then, if you take a kind of a pharmaceutical company like Glaxo, their systematic risk is something like 0.621. So they are even less than Singapore Airlines. Why? The reason is, you know, in down times, you and I may not travel, but we have to buy our medicine, pharmaceutical. So because of that, the risk for them is much, much lower. So because of this one, there's something what we call now the people who invest money, they expect what we call a return. And that return, we call it cost of equity, because that is what your shareholders are expecting, and that is the cost for the company. So this is measured by something called risk-free rate plus RM, that is the market rate, minus RF times beta. And this is what we call the CAP model. Actually, this was earlier tested in the F3, but now I don't know, in the F2 they have put it up, so better get ready for it. So risk-free rate is normally the rate that you can get without taking any risk. You invest your money on government treasury bills, probably you can get a return which is 3%. And the market rate is on average what the market pays for you, right? So it's definitely higher than the risk-free rate. So let's assume that the market pays you 7 on average company when you invest. So 7 minus risk-free rate is 3.4. Now I want to apply beta, different beta. I want to apply a beta 1. 1 is the market, your systematic risk is same as the market risk. So if you really look at that one, now what is the figure you will get? Cost of equity is equivalent to 3% plus 7 minus 3 is 4. 4 times 1 is 4. 4 plus 3 is 7%. 7%. So what does that tell us? That is the market risk, the market return. So when your systematic risk is same as the market risk, your shareholders will expect a 7% return. That is the market rate. Now I want to apply 1.5. Your risk is much more than the market. What happens? 7 minus 3 is 4. 4 times 1.5 is 6. 6 plus 3 is 9. Can you see what is happening? Because of the high risk, people are expecting a higher return. So that is what basically the theory is. Higher the risk, higher the return. So if your systematic risk is higher, the people will expect a higher return. So this is what the basically the theory part of that race part. So let's again go back to this question what we were looking at. So let's again go back to the earlier one what we were looking at, the pre-scene. So in the pre-scene we saw pre-scene, we can see Bill's historical beta is 1.8. That means their risk is more than 1.
Yeah, quite high.
Quite high, 1.8, right? The equity market premium is 6%. That is the over risk-free rate. So risk-free rate is 5. So the premium is 6%. So that means the market rate is 11. So from here, we can calculate the cost of equity that is expected by these people. So it is 5% times 6 into 1.8, 10.8, 15.8 is the expected return by the shareholder according to the cap model. So that is what it means. So let's see, as you are doing questions, let's see whether this will become relevant to us. But at the moment, let's know that one. So let's look at the board of directors. Board of director. So we have our Andrew Michel. He is the CEO. He is 53 years. He is a qualified civil engineer, formerly the managing director of Bill Civil. So you remember that there are three subsidiaries, civil, development and investment. So this man had been the managing director of civil. So there could be a one little concern about him being the CEO. He might be more supportive to Bill, to the civil engineering part of it. And of course, that is bringing the bigger revenue. That's the main part of the business. But still, for all, there is a little bit of a question mark about his independency. CEO need not be independent, but CEO should be looking at the overall strategy, should not get biased towards a particular area. So we don't know anything, but let's keep that in mind. Maybe they will say in the unseen, something like that, your finance director is telling, look here, the CEO is very, very supportive only for the civil engineering part, and the other two directors are, you know, very unhappy about it. What can you suggest about it? Some kind of a question like that can come up. So just have a note on that one. Then we have our finance director who has extensive knowledge of the construction sector. So that is going to make your life easy. She is a very knowledgeable person in the construction sector. And you are basically advising to her in many things. So you probably can talk to her in a more technical language because she knows about this construction industry. Right? And she's a qualified accountant. So you don't have too much of a difficulty. And she has already worked in a company based in Australia also. So she has the international experience also. Then we have the managing director of Bill Civil Engineering. He has joined from a major competitor, Constructmo. You remember Constructmo is our competitor, right? So from there, he has started working here. After working for the Southeast subsidiary successfully, led a new quality matters initiative to all four regional subordinates before being promoted to the managing director in 2013. So one thing you will realize is even though they have not told, Andrew Michel would have been the managing director of Bill till 2013. So Andrew Michel as the CEO is still a new fellow. Because it is not very direct, but from our analysis we can find out. Because the Mark has taken over in 2013. So Andrew Michel has been there as the CEO only for about 2 years. So probably he is going to make lot of changes as the new CEO. Then we have this Nigel. He's a qualified, so he's the managing director of development. He came from to build from some other company, major firm, a surveyor, provided professional advice for, which has provided professional advice for Bill. So he also had some pre-knowledge about the company. Nothing wrong about it because they are not the non-executive director. Then we have the Bill Investment. She came from a merchant bank, qualified in both as an accountant and a chartered surveyor. I suppose a good position for her to hold because she is in charge of real life investment. So that's the board. Then we have Melissa, company secretary. Company secretary, remember, she is not a board member, but she assists the board as the company secretary, coordinating all the board work. Then we have the non-executive directors, a fairly senior person, Daniel, who came to build as a non-executive in 2010, was appointed chairman in 2012, had previously been the finance director for another major company in the construction industry, and illustrious career. So he's a man of reputation and must be a very useful person. Mm-hmm. Right. Then we have Jesse. She's the is also the chairman of the audit committee, trustee of the major national charity, following a successful career as an academic. So we don't know whether she has any financial background, because the normally people who are in the audit committee should have some kind of a financial background. Mm-hmm. Then we have an independent non-executive director, Liu, director for several international construction, because actually when you really look at, they have put most of the things that which you have probably not covered up in your P2, F2 area, because these are mostly strategic kind of scenarios what they are given. But they can't help it, because in a company you have all these. So most of the people are not putting up any management case studies, because I think they're a little bit confused the kind of questions these people are going to ask. So we need to work out our own things, but anyway, let's see how it is going to be. So she has several international construction companies, specialist in sustainable development, environment friendly construction methodology. So she's a very specialist person, and she's going to chair the remuneration committee. That is the committee that is going to decide on the director's salaries, director's remuneration, right? So that's the committee. And then we have Hugo, who is the chairman of some company, a prestigious property investment company. He's a member of the remuneration committee. So he's a very useful man for the remuneration committee, because he's in a property investment committee. So he must be knowing... He must be knowing what's happening in the sector, so he will bring lot of input to you. So now let's look at the extract from the financial statement. So this is probably something which you will do a little bit of analysis to find out the ratios, but already some of the ratios I saw, they are given it. But let's look at on the face of it. Their revenue has increased by about 9%, I think, from 7,084 to 7,631. But the cost of sales have increased even more sharper, and therefore the gross profit, no change, 702 705. So even though the revenue have increased, the cost also have increased very rapidly. But the more important thing is, you remember that you see the other net operating expenses from 312, it has gone up to 367. So you probably can see why the share price is not moving up. Why the share price is not moving up? If you look at the bottom line, you can see 2013, they had a profit of 238 million. This year, they have 179 million. So I see, from my angle, I see the revenue has gone up, but they seem to have been a lot of problems on the costing area. Not the costing area, the cost. Cost. They seem to be spending more on the cost. So we do not know why. So that's one area that we have to keep a very close watch. That may be an area that we may need to analyze in our exam. Investment expenses, yes, 29-27. Finance expenses, 52-54. Not too many problems. But you can see profit before tax. Last year it was 367, this year 311, but the tax seems to be a little bit high even than the last year, even though the profits are lower. So maybe we don't have the tax relief or something like that, or maybe we have spent more on disallowable expenditure. Disallowable expenditure, like I don't know whether they have spent on entertainment or maybe depreciation, I'm not sure. So we have to see that one. But end of the day, your profits have come down very drastically, about 30% drop. So that obviously must be a worrying factor for the shareholders and market, and that must be the reason why the share prices have come down to the lowest level. Mm-hmm. We have no information about the previous years for us to know what kind of a share price what was there. And if you look at the intangible assets, they are 240 and 240, no changes. Property, plant and equipment, there is a change, and you know, there's a note, so we will go into note and see. Inventory, there is slightly thing. Due from construction clients have gone up very drastically. Very drastically, about 30% increase. Sales
is almost 96 million
gone up, whereas your sales did not go up by that proportion. So about 30%, so probably they are having some problem in collecting from the clients. Receivables from 15 to 23, not too much of a problem, but cash has come down from 67 to 19, which is a, and then there's something called asset sale for sale. Now, what is asset sale for sale in your financial statements? What is that? What does that reflect?
It reflects although they have been sold, but they haven't been taken over.
Yeah, it is actually the IFRS 5. It is a discontinued operation. When you discontinue operation, under IFRS 5, certain criteria are met. So you have to read the IFRS 5. I will send you a note on the IFRS 5. So probably that's the area that they may test from you. Right? They might ask, what is this asset held for sale? Last year also they had 62. This year also they have 43. Normally, that is a segment which can be totally isolated and that they have decided to dispose. So far they are not disposed, but it carries normally non-current assets, which should have been in the property, plant and equipment, but now transferred to current assets because you believe it will be sold within next 1 year. So we don't know whether that 2013-62 was sold, or whether 2062 out of 2062 only 19 is left over. In that case, the accounting treatment is wrong. In the sense, you can't have it in the last year, something which you not had any intention of selling. You must have very genuine intentions, and you must have taken all possible course of actions to sell. Then only you can put it under asset sale for sale. So seems to be they are selling some of their assets. Share capital remains same, share premium remains same, revaluation returns same, retained earnings have gone up because they had a profit, right? Then the provisions have gone up, borrowings have gone up again from 414 to 426. And again, you can see under current liabilities, another part of the borrowings, that is also going up. So you can see their cash balances are dropping, receivables are increasing, the borrowings are increasing. So they seem to be having some kind of a liquidity problem.
Cash management
is there, and that arises from one is the cost problems, cost management, because the profits are not as much as what they expected, and also the collections are not as good as what they thought. So the cash balances have come down, and the borrowings have gone. Trade payables have come down slightly, not slightly, fairly. Tax liability remains. Retirement liabilities is also slight, there's increase. So not too much of a things there, but we see problems in the cost, problems in the cash management, problems in the borrowings. So let's look at the statement of changes in equity. We can see the opening balances, profit they made of 179 and they paid a dividend of 121. So almost 70% dividend payout. 121 over 179, they have paid out a big dividend payout. So we don't know what their previous dividend policy, but seems to be paying a big dividend, right? So public limited company, your dividend policy must be somewhat consistent. People expect you a consistent pattern. Private company, it's a different story because you can negotiate with the shareholders, discuss with the shareholders and agree your dividend for the year. But public companies, thousands of shareholders, millions of shareholders, and one of the signaling effect whether the company is doing well or not is given through the dividend. So we have no clue about the last year's dividend, but we see they are paying about 70% dividend. If you look at the revenue, we can see from construction services, there is increase in revenue of about 3%, 5%. From 6488, it has gone up to about 872. And profits from sale of developments have gone up fairly from 596, almost 600 to 750, about 25%. Proceeds from sale of development, right? So, property, plant and equipment, we can see additions 158, disposals 105. Impairment, nothing. So, this is what has happened, disposals 105. So, most likely some of these disposals, we don't know whether they are most likely not disposed yet. It must be appearing under that asset held for sale.
Yeah, might be.
Yeah, maybe. Maybe. Because if they have sold it, it should have got reflected somewhere as other profits or something like that, the gain. So charges for the year, accumulated print 260, charge for the year is 23, disposals 39, right? So 105 is the cost, 39 is the disposal, so the net value is 66. So we don't know what really happened, so that's a probable question they might ask, where is this 66? The net asset, what happened to that one? How much did they sell? So we do not know that one. So that's a probable area because normally if they sell it, they will either make a loss or a gain and that should have been shown separately. So directors carried out a review of the value of property, plant and equipment, did not find any evidence of impairment. So normally IAS 19 says if there are any impairments, you must provide for it. So they have probably not found it. So share capital 240 million, $1 shares, and as at 31st September, it's going at about 350. So corporation tax rate is 35%. That's all right. What are they saying? More. So we have been given the accounting policy. So it complies with IFRS. Property, plant and equipment comprises property sale for investment purposes, a land bank intended for future development, and Bill's head office. So they are their properties. So that is their own properties, whatever they have. Property plant is held under revaluation model in accordance with IAS 16. So you remember there are two models. One is the historical cost model, other one is the revaluation model. So just after this thing, I'm going to send you a bit of a detailed note on the IAS 16, which you want. I want you to read it. Items of property, plant and equipment are carried out revalued, being the fair value at the date of revaluation less than the subsequent accumulated depreciation. Reviews are carried out by the directors on an annual basis to ensure that the carrying amount does not differ materially. And every 5 years, it is done by independent valuation, so which is a good thing. And leasing assets are classified under operating leases. So remember, we have operating leases, financial leases. In the financial lease, the risk and rewards are with us and therefore it must be treated as a financial lease, and in that case the asset gets recorded in the books, liability gets recorded in the books. But if the risk and rewards are with the owner, then we don't need to bring it, we can show it as operating lease. So you remember in this company, I think they were hiring most of the equipment, and therefore the risk and rewards are with the owner, and therefore it is operating lease is the right treatment. So that's the information we have. Then the principal risk. Now this is a very important one. So again, I see some areas which is P3 level is coming up here. So one of the risks they will have is the risk of failing to win contracts in existing and new markets. Right? So you remember I said there was one area where they said they were not able to achieve the target by West or something like that. So if they don't win contracts and if they don't get new target markets, it will lead to failure to achieve target. So probably this has happened to them. I don't know. Again, may not, because they have increased their turnover, but not too much, only by 5% in the construction industry. And the development, they have done fairly well. So mitigation, how they mitigate it, listening to our customers to ensure that we understand and meet their needs, implement cost reduction programs to ensure that we remain competitive. Now, probably that area they would not have done, because they are not cost reductive at the moment. Their cost seems to be on the high, and because of that, they may be becoming uncompetitive. They may be not getting enough business. So this is something probably the finance manager might ask you, the finance director might ask you, hey, Riaz, there's a problem here. What are we to do? So you may have to think of value analysis, customer profitability analysis, and see who are the customers who have brought you profit, who are the customers who have brought you the losses? What are the sectors that has brought you profit? What are the sectors that has brought you losses? The success of the business is problems with operational delivery cost overruns and design for. These are real risks for any construction company. Cost overruns, time overruns, design falls. So work on site is checked by in-house professionals and reports prepare so that any necessary corrective action can be taken. The board is responsible for overall quality issues and reviewing best practice. So there again, I don't know whether they, even though they have a mitigation statement, whether they have really done that one. Success of the business depends on sufficient financial facility. You seem to be drawing up on your cash resources. So cash forecasts are prepared regularly, providing accurate information. Borrowing facilities have been successfully negotiated or extended. BITS activity require the continuous monitoring and the management of health and safety risks. Failure to manage these risks could lead to injury to employees, subcontractors, and expose being legally liable. So we have detailed health safety policies. These are reviewed and monitored by the management. Business depends on a flexible, skilled, and well-motivated workforce. If we were not able to attract and retain skilled people, then business growth may not be possible. You are right. Because if you don't have right people, construction industry, if you get frustrated people, demotivated people, the quality of the project may be very bad. Start one is monitored and pay and condition regularly reviewed against benchmarks to ensure that Bill remains a competitive company. The one problem that these constructions have, the lack of laborers or the workers. Future construction open depend on the economic climate and the availability of credit for private sector expenditure. So both carries out, so that's a very important one, private sector expenditure, availability on credit for private sector expenditure. So mostly these things are spent by the government. So whether the government has money for the private sector. The board carries out a quarterly review of workload. Bill has a network of regional officers through their seal and providing strong integration with our client base. Okay. So, what else? So the chairman has given a statement. I'm happy to report a very positive result for BITS for the year ended 30th September 2014. I'm not very sure whether what he says is correct. Right? It was not a very positive thing, but I think probably he has to say like that. He is telling me. Our core business has remained profitable despite erosion of margins. So there is a problem. The profit has been supplemented by contributions from our property development subsidiary, including the successful sale of our major office development in Capital City. Bill investment has also contributed to provide positive returns. In addition to the valuable content to group revenue, our investment and development has also provided a solid asset base on which to secure borrowing. Our land bank and investment properties have shown steady growth in value. Our asset base combined with our positive relationship with lenders has enabled BIT to sustain gearing levels well in excess of our main competitor. Now this statement, you can see it does not have too much of a substance back in. He says our investment and have also provided a solid on which to secure borrowings. Our land investment has shown steady growth in value. through acquisitions, maybe. But whether it has grown in value, we do not know because we have not done a revaluation in the recent past. The revaluation is coming up only in 2017. So we seem to be having gearing level much in excess of our main competitors. So whether it's a good sign or not, something questionable. We are looking, so you can see the chairman is basically giving a very, very kind of a optimistic picture. And normally, this is not the chairman's role, right? Normally, they're not, this is the CEO's role. CEO only should be talking about the performance. Chairman should be talking about the policies and that kind of thing, and the board's role, that kind of a thing. So it looks like he has mixed up the chairman's role with his role. We are the CEO's role. We are looking ahead to substantial opportunities in the marketplace where we have already demonstrated their skills, experience, financial resources to complete and succeed. So again, financial resources, that's a question mark. So this chairman's report, I think, is coming to a lot of criticism. So this is something that you may be asked because sometimes maybe just after these reports, there may be a press article criticizing your chairman's report. He's telling something which is not reflected in your financials. So you may be called by your finance director and told, look here, there's an article about the chairman's report. How are we going to respond to this one? Now that's the role of the finance director because whether the chairman makes a statement or not, it doesn't matter. Now the finance director will have to substantiate, justify it. He can't attack the chairman, but he may have to give some good reasons. We have been successful in securing a number of contracts and have been also been able to extend some existing contracts. Our order book is almost at the same level as September 2013, despite challenging economic conditions. So it's contradictory, right? He's basically he's saying it's at the level of September 2013, but on the he says we have been able to, you know, get it. So I'm sure this is one statement that will come for a lot of criticism by the press media, and you may be asked to work on that one. Look at our competitor, Constructmo. Constructmo. They have done a lesser sale than you, I think, if I remember. No. Who did the higher sale? Okay, we will see it later on, right? But they have a good profit of 236 million compared to our profit. All seem to be within range. Because in fact their sales have dropped, costs have dropped, right? Net operating expenses have dropped. So they seem to be managing their cost much, much more better than we. And probably that may be making them more competitive. And that's why they have a better sale than us. So you can see the difference that is coming up. So we may want to take something from our pre-seen here for our analysis. So there are big intangible assets, 798 to 730, there's a drop. But what are these intangible assets is something which we need to worry about. Their property, plant and equipment is very little. They are very little tangible assets. Inventory, slight increase. Deformed construction clients, they also have increased, but not as what we have done. Trade receivables, they have a big trade receivable. We don't have too much of trade receivables, so they might be selling certain things which we are not doing it. Cash, there's a slight drop, but not as much as what we have expected. Share premium, all that remains same. Retained earnings have come down. That is because we have paid a big dividend. Provisions have gone up. Borrowings same. Deferred tax thing. Trade payables, borrowings have come down there. So they don't seem to be having too much of a problem compared to our company on the liquidity side. Look at the key ratio. Now this is what sometime most likely we'll have to analyze it. Gross profit 9.9, 9.2 billion. Construction, gross profit, construct more, 7% and 7%. So they seem to be spending more on cost than us. Profit for the year as a percentage of revenue, both are same. 2.4, 2.4. So they got 9.0, we got 9.2 and we have ended up at 2.4. That means we are spending 6.8% on our expenditure. Whereas these people got 7 and then spent 2.4, so they are spending only 4.6% on their expenditure. So they seem to be managing their expenditure better than us. Look at ROC. ROC is very much better in the competitor company.
Yeah.
Our ROC has come down drastically from 26 to 21, a very sharp drop, very sharp drop. So probably we are not utilizing our assets properly. We have enough assets but not making a lot of money. Gearing, we are 45%. Even the construct more 45%. So remember that man, Chairman, said that, you know, we are in a better position, that our gearing is much more higher than the others. But with the construct more, we don't seem to be in that position also. We almost same. So I'm sure the Chairman's statement will come to a lot of criticism in the press. That is some area that you may be asked to work it out. What does 2015 hold for the construction industry? So construction industry is not really cyclical. Activity is high when the economy prospers and low during downturns. So how does the economy look in 2015? Range from very small run building firms to major contractors. So we are obviously a major contractor. For this article, we are focused on those with a turnover in excess of 100 million. So we are above that one. This gave us a sample of 63 companies, 5 fewer than last year, because one company has since gone into receivership, another 4 have had their revenue decline below 100 million. So looks like the at least 5 firms have really gone down from last year. Although construction output increased, there are worrying signs, now that's a very important one, that the rate of growth is slowing down. This may be not too dampening, as there is also evidence of capacity constraint. So what they say is the industry is not growing fast, but it is not going to worry too much because your capacity has not increased in the sector. So with subcontract availability falling sharply and steep increases in the demand for construction material. So subcontractors also becoming a little bit tough for you. It will always be a struggle to maintain activity levels because even the largest contractors find that their ongoing workload comprises a small number of very large contracts. So when you have too many small contracts, a number of very large contracts but small ones, your overheads are going to go up. Because you're going to supervise 100 sites instead of supervising 5 sites. So that is most likely that would have happened to these people also. The successful completion of a shopping mall or motorway extension leaves a void in the order book. So those things are not happening. No more road development happening, no more shopping malls are coming up. So that is going to have a big impact on the construction industry. Construction companies tend to have low gearing levels. Average gearing is 17%. But remember, we have 45%. With 12 of our companies having no debt at all. So there are 12 companies, zero gearing. Return on capital employed average 23%. So we are also in that range, I think. We were slightly lower, so I think, but operating profit average only 1.5% of reported revenue. So we were about 2.4, I think. 7 of our companies had a company health score that were low enough to cause concern that they may be financially vulnerable. We are not sure whether our companies are also included in that category. Seems to be somewhat financially vulnerable, but not too bad, but somewhat vulnerable. How many companies will survey when we survey next? We'll repeat this exercise next year. Steady rise in cost and downward pressure on the prices in a highly competitive market may mean that even the largest will struggle to maintain their forward workload. So, good hint from the papers or the articles about the construction industry. Not a very rosy picture. Somewhat in totally in contradiction with our Chairman's picture. So let's look at the economics today. So in January 2015, just 2 months before, the private finance institute. So I want you to read up some articles about the PFI.
Okay.
Right, private finance. This is basically the private public partnerships. The private sector come in to support the government sector projects. Have been wisely used in many countries as a procurement method to deliver public sector infrastructure projects. So water projects, electricity projects, road projects, they get the government, the private sector involved in the project. So some projects call what they call the build, own and operate. Some projects build, operate and transfer. Some projects basically private sector participation, private sector management. Recent announcements by the Sri Lankan government indicate that the following a successful series of pilot projects, this type of finance is now to be used in Sealand for the provision of new schools, hospitals and roads. So the government as a matter of policy has taken a decision to go ahead with the PFI for schools,
okay,
hospitals and roads. And that is the area our company build will be very focused. So PFI combines the broad term of PPP, public-private partnership. Under PFI, a private sector developer pays for the construction of a project on behalf of a public sector client. So you will have a private sector developer come in and hire in the build as the contractor to put up a school on behalf of the government, to put up a water project on behalf of the government. So there's a private sector developer come in. So when the private sector developer comes, he will contract with build, but build will have to be very, very competitive. So yeah, once built, the client developer leases the resulting school, hospital or whatever on a fully service basis for an agreed period spanning the expected life of the building. So the developer provides cleaning, catering and maintenance, while the public sector clients pays the teachers, the medical staff and supply the textbooks. The companies offering these services claim that it provides an exciting new means of funding public sector services. So there's a developer who will come and put a school on behalf of the government. Government will take it on a lease and pay to the developer the lease rent and will pay the salaries of the teachers and run the school. Ownership is with that developer, but the operations are done by the government. So the capital funding comes from the developer. So the client for the build company is the developer, not the government any longer. But government will have somewhat a say in deciding the contractor. Government will say, these contractors we don't want, or we want a particular class of contractors, A grade, B grade company, that kind of a thing. So companies offering this service, they provide an exciting means of funding public sector activities. Politicians are often attracted by the fact they can improve public infrastructure without having to find the money upfront, because the government budgets are becoming very constrained. So because of that, they go for this private PFI fund. Announcing the new initiative, a Sri Lankan government spokesman said that we hope that PFI will deliver new projects more quickly than the public sector acting alone and at a lower rate. Why do they think it can happen at a faster rate? Now, when you... Yes, what is the situation?
Because private sector people are more efficient.
Yeah, more flexible, more efficient. Government, the tender process itself will take 2 years, 3 years.
They are too
bureaucratic. And therefore, most of the projects can be done much more faster, much more flexibly with the private sector involvement. Yeah, right. That's the reason, right? And deliver new projects acting alone and at a lower risk, because they will manage their risk very well. Although some countries have had problems with PFI initiatives, we believe that the Sri Lankan can learn more from others' mistakes to ensure that the projects represent good value for money for Sri Lankan's taxpayers, while also provide high quality buildings and services. The government spokesman was questioned about the recent public inquiry in neighboring country D-Land into PFI project to build big city hospital. The project suffered from major cost overruns because the building specification was constantly changed in response to the new medical technologies that became available during the design and building phase of the project. Now, this is one problem when you have the PFI project. The government will come and change the requirements all the time.
Yeah.
And there have been made public protests about the level of cleanliness in the hospital and the standard of food provided for patients. Now, that is done not by the developer, it is done by the government, right? Protesters have claimed that these problems are attributable to the developer's incentive to minimize cost in order to maximize profit, even if doing it were at the expense of patients' care. So this is a problem all the time. Private sector is totally profit-oriented. Totally profit-oriented. So you remember this one, whatever on a school basis, on agreed planning, so the developer provides cleaning. So they are very worried about the cost. They might reduce on cleaning and all that kind of a thing, and that can have an impact upon your service. So this always happens with the private sector, right? Even if they're doing at the expense of the patient care. So these are very sensitive predicts. Sri Lanka government spokesman insisted that the governments had visited the several projects in overseas countries, including the big city. Although this project has had problems, there have been many examples of successful projects. We remain confident that the partnership can deliver high quality schools and hospitals in Sri Lanka. So this last statement basically gives you an indication of the trends for or the opportunities for our company. Because the government is very supportive, even though there have been some critical criticisms of some of the projects, government thinks, no, don't worry about that one. We can do very well. We will do very well. So no need for you to worry about it. So as a company, the bill will have to have strategies to have relationship with these property developers. Developers. So they have to build up relationship with property developers, which is a new marketing strategy for them, so that they can get these businesses when it comes up. And also they have to have good relationship with the government. Both sides, they have to do it. So this is basically the pre-scene, but we have seen it. So basically you can see what are the points that you can get out of this pre-scene. What I saw was a good set of people are there, but probably the industry is going through a little bit of a crisis, and our company seems to be having some problems with the cost management, cost controls, cost management, and also the government does not seem to be having too much of money, but they are looking at this PFI initiative. Industry itself is not so bad, but not doing very well at the moment. So these are some of the things that you have to pick it up from the pre-scene. So I don't see too much of F2 in it. There'll be lot of E2 in it, lot of P2 in it, I would say. But there can be a little bit of analysis, that kind of a thing. So what I did was, based on this one, I prepared a kind of an unseen for you. So remember, there are three subsidiaries here. Build engineering, then build investment, and build development. Yeah. So I have taken the first task, I taken from the build investment. That's the subsidiary that is renting out the houses, renting out the buildings they construct, and they do renting out. So build investment subsidiary has completed the buildings of 30 apartments in December 2003, long time back. And immediately sold 15 of them for 120,000 each. However, no apartments have been sold since that day. So for about 12 years, nothing has happened. Until now, BID has operated in a buy and market. So this has led to some concern across the company, right? So why these things are not selling? To try and understand the industry better, the marketing manager has forecast the following changes in property prices during the next year. So you have to pick these notes now, right? What you're expecting is next year there are going to be a 10% increase. Next year also it is going to be a 2% increase. But after that, the property prices are going to go up. Property prices are going to go up. So you are the senior management accountant working in the finance division of Bill, which we know at their head office. It is currently March 2015 and you have been in the company for 5 years. You have just received the following email from the finance director, this Felicity, right? So Felicity is writing to you. Hello, I would like your inputs, please. I'm due to attend a board meeting later today where we'll be discussing the 15 unsold apartments. 15, so out of 30, 50 sold, 15 sold, 15 not sold. What else? In response to the decline in market, the marketing manager has proposed and financially evaluated two possible alternative marketing strategies as a way of attempting to sell them. The CEO has asked all of us as board members to assess these strategies and feedback our thoughts at this meeting. So he is going to attend the board meeting later today, and now he is suddenly calling you and asking you all these details. Before I can respond, I would really benefit from your expertise here. Please, can you consider the relative merits of the two marketing strategies proposed by marketing manager and recommend with reasons which strategy should we adopt? Details of each strategy are attached to this email. You can assume that the figures are correct. Now, this is, I think, they will always tell us. We don't need to recheck the figures, recalculate the figures. Assume that the figures are correct. Because we don't have an Excel worksheet in the computer. We don't have the we have a simple calculator. So I think the best thing to do is to always, I think they will say, even if they don't say, assume that the figures given is correct. Unless you see something really crazy figure. Write your response to Felicity. So let's look at the two strategies what they are talking about. So, marketing strategy one, sell the properties at a discounted rate of 150. So remember they were selling at 125. They want to sell it at 115. This would require a marketing campaign that involves spending 210,000. So you spend 210,000. Market research suggests that there's a 70% chance that all the units will be sold within 6 months. But a 30% chance that none will be sold. Now that's a risk you have to take. This is what we call the expected value. 70% probability everything will be sold. 30% probability nothing will be sold. Under this strategy, all money will be paid and received by 31st December 2015. So in 9 months time, you will get all your money. So that is one strategy. Second one, it's a mix of strategies. Second one, it requires spending 75,000 on advertising. So the first one, 210. Second one, 75. The marketing manager expects that the remaining 15 apartments will be sold under this strategy. Marketing involves offering potential the choice of three different deals. So there are three different packages, I would say, to sell. Number one, customers can buy an apartment at a reduced price of 95,000. And if they agree to a rapid transfer of ownership. So basically, no more 125 selling, no more 115 selling, it is going to go at 95. Yeah, and if they agree to a rapid transfer of ownership, deposit is payable immediately and the remaining in 8 weeks time. So in 2 months time, everything will be done. Whereas other one, till 31st December, 9 months time. And marketing manager expects 8 will be sold under this arrangement. So deal 1, they will sell it at 95, get 10% upfront, balance in 2 weeks, 2 months time, 8 will go out of that one. Deal 2, purchasers will be given the opportunity to purchase an apartment of 110,000 with a guarantee that if they wish to sell at any time during the next 5 years, Bill will purchase the property back at this initial price. So, you are giving me a kind of a carrot. 110, I can buy it, but anytime, next 5 years, I can sell it back to you at 110. So, So if the market price drops, surely I'm going to come back and sell it to you. Yeah. Bill will purchase the property back at this initial price. Under this deal, all sales receipts will be received within next 3 months. So first one, it's going to take 9 months. Second one, in 2 months time, it will come. Deal two, money will come within 3 months. And Direct expects to sell 5 apartments. And that they will be all repurchased by 2017. Oh, all those 5 that will be sold will come back to you because 2017, we see the prices are going to come down and the people, you see prices coming down, now prices going back. What's happening? 2007.
Prices going up.
So I can't see, I don't know why they are wanting to do that one, but that is what the marketing manager says. If the prices are going up, I don't see any logic in them wanting to sell it back to you. Yeah, right. Then the deal three. So 5 will go out of that one. Customer will be given the opportunity to purchase an apartment for 105 payable in 3 months time, plus a further payment of 25,000 after 10 years. Oh, that you have to pay it after 10 years. So 105 you will collect it today, but 10 years after that you will get another 25,000. Or when the customer sells the apartment, whichever occurs first. The marketing director, 2 apartments will be sold under this arrangement. So this is how he is going to, his strategies. So this is your first part. So let's look, so we are given the attachment two. So the financial evaluation. So the marketing strategy one, they have done the calculations. We don't need to do it. It is going to bring you a positive NPV of 950. Marketing strategy two, with all what they have done, immediately 75 deal one, deal two, deal three, all that, it is going to bring you 1,018% value. Total cost of building the apartment was 75,000 each. So that will not come in this calculation because that's already a sunk cost. Right? It is thought that the only additional cash flow that will arise will be for marketing and selling the remaining 50 apartments. And that's right. Because you will not take the 75,000 because that's a sunk cost. Now you may have a question something like that. Giving a calculation like this and put in that 75,000, in that case you have to comment and say that is wrong.
Yeah.
You should not take the 75,000 because that's already a sunk cost.
Already been accounted
for. Yeah. So 950 is the strategy one, 1,018 is the strategy two. So that is basically what is given in the for the task one. Task two we will not look at today. So let's look at the task one. So what I've been asked, before I can respond, I will really benefit from your expertise here. Can you consider the relevant merits of the two marketing strategies and recommend with reason which strategy? So definitely he's asking for a recommendation. So we have a strategy one, strategy two. So looking at the things, I will have to note down in my scratch pad what are the points I'm going to talk about. What are the points? Remember, my cash balances are really coming down. Yeah. So I'm facing a somewhat a cash crisis. Strategy one will bring me money in December.
Yeah.
Strategy two, either way, will bring me money within the 2-3 months time. So that's one factor that I have to consider because my cash flow position is not very strong. So on that one, the strategy two is bringing me much earlier. Then coming back to the NPVs, we can see strategy two is much better.
Yeah.
Strategy 2 is much better, 1018. And also in the strategy 1, we can see we have to spend upfront on the advertisements, 210,000, whereas on the other one, we have to spend only 75,000. So that's another thing that you probably want to look at. So then the strategy 1 is a very simple one, no complexity. Very simple, you sell, collect your money. But the other three strategies all are fairly complicated ones, particularly the deal two and the deal three. Deal two, there's a buyback arrangement. Deal three, there's a 25,000 coming after 10 years. Deal one, 10% deposit, 90% payable in 8 weeks time. So even for the customer, three deals, he will be thinking of many things, very complex one. Whereas the strategy one, a very simple, straightforward. You sell it, and also you can sell it, and you can say you'll be selling at a higher price. You'll be selling at marketing manager, I think it was going at 125, 115. Much more than any of the other ones are bringing. Other ones, 95, 110, 105. So, but only thing, you're going to spend a lot of money on this. So you will do a simple calculation. Try to find out the money you will get on this one. 115 into 15 minus 210.
It would be 1.5.
Into 15.
15 into 15 is...
Yeah.
225.
Yeah, that's right. Then from that 210.
17.25.
1.725. Yeah. Out of that 210 will go as expenditure.
Yes, 1565.
Yeah, that is what you will get it if you sell it on the strategy one. Strategy two, you will get 95,000. Within the on the 95,000 on 8 apartments, 95,000 on the 8 apartments, deal 2 will bring 110 into 5, and also the other one will bring 105 into 2. So you can do some simple calculations. Yeah.
95
into 8.
760.
Yeah, 760. Then you get 110 into 5.
550.
Yeah, 550. So 760 plus 550. And also, because the balance 25,000 is coming up into after so many years, but you will get 105 into 2. 210. Immediately, not immediate.
It's 1.520.
You will get it. Out of that, you will be spending 75,000.
Yeah.
So 1.4545. Saturday one will bring much more bigger money. Little later.
Yeah.
Little later, but it will bring bigger money, right?
Yeah.
So some of the factors that you will want to consider are that one. So, if you are writing a letter, the memo, you will say, surely, strategy one brings a better NPV from the shareholder wealth point of view. That's the more advantageous one. But there's a risk. There's a 70% chance everything will be sold, 30% chance that nothing will be sold.
Yeah.
So, that is always a risk on that one. Right? Other ones, we can see, the sales happening 8, 5 and 2, but of course on 1, the 5 again will have to be returned back after 5 years.
Yeah.
So, now one thing that you may want to consider, you are advising the board of directors or this finance person, how reliable are this information? Who gave you this information? Right? The information is given by the marketing director, marketing manager. Is it? So you may want to talk about that one, because your recommendations, calculations, everything is depending on the marketing director's recommendation, marketing director's thing. On which basis has he told you this?
Yeah.
And I have a doubt already, because in 5 years' time we expect the property prices to go up. So if the property prices are going up, there is no reason for us to expect that the 5 apartments will come back to us.
Yeah.
So these are the points that you are going to talk about.
Okay.
And on the cash flow basis, you will see this other, the deal 2 will bring money early, the strategy 2.
Yeah.
Strategy 2 will bring the money early. I want to, you remember that they had some the cash balance are 60 odd million. So spending 210,000 may not be a big problem.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
210 or 75 may not be a big problem because they have enough money. So it may not be a big problem. But that is also another point. You have to see if they were to spend about 50 million, that may be a problem for you. Then strategy one, it's a very simple package, right? And in the strategy one, we have time till December. So yeah. Nothing may get sold today, but we have time till December. By December, if the people know that the prices are going to go up, they might buy it. They might come and buy it, right? If the customers expect the prices to come down, they may wait for some more time. So that's the 30% chance that nothing will happen up.
Yeah.
Then buying back arrangement is another problem, because if the property prices are going up, there's no reason why you should not buy back. But then the money availability is a thing that we have to look at.
Yeah.
So why the strategy two is becoming more attractive is because it is giving some installments, it is giving some buyback arrangements, all that kind of a thing. So finally, it will all depend on the economic conditions of the country. Now what we see is, what according to our forecast, it's going to go up. But we don't know how the marketing director has forecasted all these things. So my recommendation is, I need more time to look at the forecast given, whether these things are, or marketing data must come and justify it between me. Having said that, one final decision will depend to a great extent the kind of risk the board is prepared to take it. Will they prepare to wait till December and see whether they can sell the 100%, or they may have a probability of not selling anything, or whether they want to go with the deal two and sell quickly. So it all depends on what we call the risk appetite of the organization, the levels of risk that the company is prepared to take. Then also, as I said, it will depend very much on the information. How reliable is marketing director's figures? My recommendation is you must appoint a team to go into this one and see whether the figures are reliable, because other marketing department people are generally, they don't have that much of a base. They just give the figures on an optimistic note. So having done that one, I must finally come to my recommendation. So one thing is, on the strategy two, I have few problems. The second deal, of course, only 225,000, that is going to come 10 years later. So 10 years is too long a period even to think of, and the money value, you will not have any money value. Any money value on that one. So I want to see whether they have done a NPV, whether they don't tell us the NPV cost of capital figure, but if it is about 7%, 10%, after 10 years, it does not have any value at all.
Yeah,
and the apartments have not been sold for long number of years, so there is a good possibility after some time people return in for various defects and all that when they are not fully paid in. So you might as well sell it on a fully paid basis. So strategy two, the deal one seems okay, but deal two and three are a little bit not okay. But if you really look at the deal two, deal 3, out of 100, and you are getting 105, so it's much better than the deal 2 in a way. Upfront you are getting 105. Much better than the deal 1. Deal 1 you are getting only 95. So 101 you are getting upfront, 105. So that looks a better deal from the company's point of view. But unfortunately, 2 units are going to sell, right? So finally, having discussed all those things in different ways, you must come out with your recommendation. Now, in your view, what is your recommendation going to be?
Yeah, if I would definitely go for the strategy one.
Strategy one. What is the reason? Good. Yes.
Although there is a risk of 30%,
yeah,
none will be sold. But then, why is the marketing manager there?
Mm.
he's not able to sell like anything.
And
why is he there?
And after spending 210,000.
10,000, what is he doing there?
Yeah.
He will be there then.
So
if it is a risk, even the probability is 70% chance that we would sell all of those.
Correct. Correct.
And there won't be anything lagging behind, like 25,000 pounds, $100 of 10 years, something like that.
Yeah.
You would have cash instantly.
Yeah.
And 9 months, they're not a big deal in the corporate sector.
Right, exactly. Exactly, because when you look at your financial position, it's not a crashing situation where you have to do it. Because sometimes when you come out with the deal strategy too, it may give wrong signaling effect to the market that you are trying to push to
show that you are desperate.
Desperate, exactly. Now that's a good business skill point, right? A business skill point. You don't want to be showing some desperation like that. You want to be very open. So this is the way you should be discussing. Now you saw this is one part of it. I did it right. So basically this is the way. So now I think you were coming out with lot of good feedback, right? How did you get all that? Because you did not read a textbook or anything. You saw the scenario, you saw the problems, and you analyzed the problem. After analyzing, you see many things. And very simple. And the last thing I like, what I like was what you said, that the other second scenario can show some desperation. You're trying to sell it very low. When you have already sold it for 125 earlier, right? 125 earlier, and suddenly coming down to 95 and all that, even will disappoint the 15 people who have bought it earlier. Is it right? The people who have bought it from you at 125 will be disappointed. My gosh, they are coming out at 95. And
they might go to court as well.
They also may want to. Now, these are the good points that you can catch it up from the pre-seen, right? From the unseen. So you don't want to disturb your market because you are a going concern. You have to be in business tomorrow. Some of the clients who bought the properties, apartments from you, going to buy another property tomorrow. But a 10,000 difference can be explained because the market prices are coming down next 2 years.
$10,000, I don't think people would bother.
No one will be bothered because the prices are coming down. Because, say, in the car market, suddenly you might see the car prices coming down. When everything is coming down, it will come down. So you have to reduce your price. If you try to stick to your gun of 125, no one is going to buy it. And probably that could have happened. Probably that would have happened. They were not able to sell it because the market prices would have been coming down, but we were trying to stick to the guns. So my recommendation is do a more thorough analysis, get the marketing director's figures vetted, verified by a team, appoint a team, get it verified. And if all the figures are correct, go for strategy one. And push the marketing director to sell it.
Make it happen.
To make it up, yes. Give him a task and say that you are spending 210,000, your role is this, and do it. Don't come out with excuses. That is how you will push a business decision. What you said was very nice. You said that what is the purpose of having a marketing manager? Yes. Right. If there were no marketing manager, I would have recommended to appoint a marketing manager. To give it a try. But here we have a marketing manager. What is he doing? He's not here to give us forecast and analysis and all that. Ask him to go with the strategy one. Sell it. 9 months more. Collect the money. We don't want the 30% risk. We want the 70% outcome to be converted into 100% outcome. That kind of a voice from the CEO will push the thing through. Right. So what I want is, I want you to look at the section 2 of that part by your own. And also on the section 1, I want you to write it. Write your own answer. Take it up a Word document, write it and send it to me. I will go through and try to correct it for you.
Okay.
That's the way we are going to go ahead. So I'll send you some notes on the IS 19 and all that, which will be relevant. So I'm ping. We don't have a kind of structured case studies. BPP is not has not come out. Kaplan has not come out. Astranth is not coming out. Anyone is not coming out. But this is what I did for you. So like that, I will work out some mocks, and we will try to go through these things.
Have you seen the SEMA exam preparation notes?
Yeah, yes.
I haven't seen those. Should I buy those or
SEMA, what do you mean, SEMA exam preparation notes?
study material, preparation material on SEMA's website?
I'll go through that one. I saw that, but I didn't read too much. I'll go through that one. I'll let you know whether it is really necessary for you. Okay, I'll go
And
to.
you know, the recording you sent me last time,
Okay.
it didn't open. I don't know why.
Oh, All right, okay. I will try to upload it to the YouTube link and give you the link in this case. Okay. So I'll try to do that one. Because normally I send the link and it should be opening, but maybe but is the, yeah, you using a laptop or what are you using?
Yeah, I'm using a laptop. But last time, you know, we didn't use WebEx.
You know,
We
even
just
the,
checked it.
yeah, even this time I did not use WebEx, but the conversation gets recorded with the Skype. Yeah, right. But I'll see that one. I'll send you a YouTube link and it should be okay. Right. Okay then.
The notes you were, last time we discussed, I need to go through the IS.
IS 19, I have already done a note. I'll send you that one today or tomorrow morning. I'll send you the IS 19 note. And I want you to look at the construction accounts.
Yeah, I think it's IS 17 or
Yeah,
something.
17, I think. Yes, construction accounts. I want you to look at that one. And I will let you know as we go on what are the notes you have. You are sitting for the May exam, no?
March.
March exam. Okay, right. Okay, right. So I will tell you in the leasing also will be a good thing to go through.
Yeah, leasing. Yeah.
The IS 15, because they are taking some leases and all that, so you may be asked to discuss on that also. Okay then, I'll see you. We are meeting normally. We are meeting on Tuesdays, no?
Yeah.
Yeah. So we will meet next Tuesday.
Hopefully.
Yeah. Okay.
Chal.
Yeah. Right. Okay. So I'll see you next Tuesday. Hopefully, yes.
All right.
Okay.
Take care, yeah?
Thank
Take care.
you. Take care.
Thank you.
Bye. Bye. Bye.